Gospers received a master's degree in English from the Iowa State University and a PhD in philosophy from Columbia University. He's taught at numerous universities and currently holds a post at the University of Southern California. At present, he is also editor of the philosophical quarterly The Monist and president of the American Society for Aesthetics. Mr. Hospice, Professor Hospice, is author of the book Libertarianism, which paved the way for the founding of the Libertarian Party in the United States, of which he was also the first candidate for president in 1972. Apart from all this, Professor Hospice has published widely, his titles including Meaning and Truth in the Arts and Understanding the Arts. More recently, he has published a number of articles in The Freedom. These papers deal with subjects such as equality, freedom and utopias, freedom versus democracy, and justice versus social justice. Professor Hospice visited South Africa in 1983 and is currently on a countrywide tour. This is actually the tail end of it, where he will address campuses, the President's Council, and the CISCAR Cabinet. In the light of his achievements, many of which I have not even mentioned, I have no doubt Professor Hospice will provide a very enlightening and entertaining speech on the idea of democracy. There will be time for questions after.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here. I've been in South Africa traveling about for a little over a month, and this is the last official engagement, apparently. The best would save it for the last. What is government good for? To begin with that question. After all, government prohibits endless activities. Government can be defined as the institution and the only institution that constitutes a monopoly on the use of physical force throughout geographical area. And the question naturally arises, why haven't government began probably as a kind of mutual protective association? But of course it doesn't always continue to be just that. In history, it's probably safe to say that governments have killed more people than all private killers put together. Slaughtered millions in wars of conquest, attempts of others to defend themselves against those aggressors, sent millions of people to death camps. It's easy to make a case for saying that government is the greatest possible enemy of freedom. And yet, government does have a function. And let me suggest, we'll explore this a little, that the main purpose of government should be to enhance freedom, to maximize freedom. Now, how is this possible? I want to distinguish first two different functions of government. The prohibitive and the enabling function. People aren't usually as conscious of the enabling function, so I'll say just a word about that at the outset. Government enables certain activities to exist that could not otherwise exist, precisely because it does have the coercive power that nothing else has. If you have a book or article that you want to get copyrighted, government will provide service. It will protect you against people who would pirate it. You are not required to take advantage of this, but you may do so if you wish. It enables the protection to occur. Or again, suppose someone wanted to adopt homeless children and went around gathering them up. Without a legal process of adoption, other people could just come in and pick them up again from the person who originally did. Or again, property itself. Suppose someone has an estate and wants to rescue an endangered species of bird or animal. If you didn't have that title to the property registered and your property protected by government, anyone else could come in and shoot the animals that you were attempting to protect. So the very coercive power of government enables certain activities to occur that would not otherwise occur. However, back to the primary thing about government, and that is its prohibitions. Prohibit us from doing many things that we would like to do. But you see, the prohibitions themselves can also increase liberty. There's a prohibition against murder, mayhem, assault, theft. And what these prohibitions mostly require of you is the restraining of certain aggressive impulses. You are prohibited from doing, from expressing yourself in certain ways that you might want to. But what do you get for this in return? You may have a favorite enemy that you'd like to get rid of, but you might also be somebody else's favorite enemy. And in this case, government protects you against aggressions by other people, at least if government functions. People do this. And it's the same with theft and all crimes of violence. What it requires of you, namely the restraint of your impulses, is a small thing compared with what it offers in return, namely protection. Enables civil society to exist and takes us out of our Hobbesian state of nature. That's at least government as it ought to be. Most governments, needless to say, are not like that, and they go far beyond them. One question that arises immediately is, what form of government is best calculated to preserve freedom? And here the usual answer is democracy. Now, if the word democracy means that people should participate in the affairs of their government, then of course I have nothing to say against it. It's certainly better if they participate than if they are unwilling subjects to a tyranny. On the other hand, there can be some objections taken to unlimited democracy, simply ruled by the majority. Either direct democracy, where each citizen votes, as in ancient Athens, or indirect democracy, as with most modern governments, where people vote for representatives in Parliament or Congress, who then do the voting on their behalf. Now, I must mention some dangers in democracy and suggest what I think is preferable to it before we go on. Two main objections. One is that in the rule of the majority, the majority can persecute or even vote to abolish and kill a minority. Mike? Well, have been the case that the majority of the German citizenry in the 1930s were in favor of Hitler. Looks as if that is the case. There are, in an unlimited democracy, there is no protection of a minority against the whims or prejudices of a majority. And that's certainly one source of insecurity about it. The second problem with democracy is not so often mentioned, but is even more serious, I think, and that is that in a democracy, people can vote short-sightedly, ignorantly, for measures which they haven't thought through and whose final consequences they would not willingly bring upon themselves, but nevertheless do. Popular example. People vote themselves large benefits from government. It's nice to receive something for nothing. But then, those have to be financed in some way. Then you either go into debt, or you have to pay higher taxes every year, or you inflate the currency so that the rand isn't worth as much this year as it was last year, and so on and so on. But there's no pleasant option at that stage. People in democracy have voted for this, or their representatives have, and often the representatives won't get reelected unless they do vote for these benefits. But the benefits are short-lived, and very often the consequences take a long time to come home, but can be much worse than the benefits. It started to enjoy. That's why democracies have historically often turned into dictatorships. Democracies, nevertheless, are so popular in concept that even the most tyrannical dictatorships like to call themselves people's democracies. The word democracy has to come in somewhere for it to be respectable. When Benito Juarez, the first president of Mexico, said, I quote, "Since people do not vote themselves into slavery, freedom flows from democracy as water flows from the hills." His doubtless words were doubtless inspiring and eloquent to his audience, but there's just one problem with them. They weren't true. People do often vote themselves into slavery without meaning to at the outset. That's why Louis Napoleon once characterized democracy cynically as government of the cattle, for the cattle, by the cattle. And Plato himself, 2,500 years ago, had some insightful things to say about democracy. That is now the unlimited democracy which he experienced in Athens. And we quote just very briefly from Book 8 of the Republic. Imagine this state of affairs on board a ship. The master is bigger and burlier than the crew, but a little short-sighted. The sailors are quarreling over the control of the helm. Each thinks he ought to be steering the vessel, though he's never learned navigation and cannot point to any teacher under whom he has served. They all cry up as a skilled navigator and master in seamanship, anyone who's clever enough to lend a hand in persuading or forcing the master to set them in command. Every other kind of person they condemn as useless. They do not understand that the genuine navigator can only make himself fit to command a ship by studying the seasons of the year and the sky and stars and winds and everything that belongs to his craft. And they have no idea that along with the science of navigation, it is possible for them to gain by instruction or practice the skill to keep control of the helm. If a ship were managed in that way, those on board would be likely to call the expert in navigation a mere stargazer. Spent his time in idle talk and was useless. But, Plato concludes, our present rulers may be compared to the sailors in our parable, and the useless visionaries, as the politicians call them, to the masters of navigation. Democracy promotes to honor anyone who merely calls himself the people's friend. Well, that was written 2,500 years ago, but it sort of rings a bell today. There are many similar remarks made that have been made today. One very grateful contemporary American author, Rose Wilder Lane, says, "No one imagines that a majority of passengers should control a plane, or assumes that by majority vote, the patients, nurses, elevator boys, and cooks, and ambulance drivers, and interns, and telephone operators, and students, and scrub women in a hospital should control the hospital. Would you ride on a train if all the passengers stepped into booths and elected the train crews by majority vote?" So on. Well, if all these things are so objectionable about democracy, what is the alternative? democracy is often confused with something else, and that is a constitutional republic. What's the difference in a constitutional republic? The Constitution puts certain restraints upon what the majority may do or enact. The United States, for example, I'll talk a lot about the United States before making a few concluding comments about South Africa. According to the American Constitution, the government, the federal government, is restrained from doing a large number of things. That is, it consists largely in specifications of what the government may not do, not what it may do. It may not sentence anyone without due process of law. The government may not invade your home, at least not without a search warrant giving probable cause. And if they're looking for one thing that's illegal and they find something else that is, they can't get you for the second one. You can't have property taken away from you, again, unless special circumstances arise. If they have to build a road, then they have to give you the market value. They can, more important, they can't interfere with freedom of speech and press. See, in a democracy, a majority may easily be inflamed, especially in times of crisis, and they will pass laws against dissenters. Whereas in the First Amendment of the American Constitution, we have this provision, Congress shall pass no law abridging freedom of speech or of the press. And it doesn't say, unless the majority so vote. Now this is a very important provision. It means that people can say what they want. They can't incite to crime and that sort of thing because that's considered action and not just speech. They can speak their opinion. Even if the opinion is totally against the governmental position, they are protected by this constitutional provision in whatever they wish to say. This is freedom of speech, freedom of press, and freedom of peaceable assembly, all of which were embedded in the original Constitution and which are still pretty much honored. The First Amendment is one of the foundations of the American Constitutional Republic, provides guarantees that you would not have in a democracy. One of the most important things that was provided unwittingly in the American Constitution was economic freedom. That is, freedom of production and trade, which makes prosperity possible. It's really not mentioned in the Constitution. The founding fathers were anxious to take every measure possible to avoid the tyrannies that they had encountered in Europe. It was freedom from tyranny that they were mostly interested in. They had no idea what an economic colossus the United States was going to become. But that was the very beauty of it. Restriction on economic freedom was not one of the powers entrusted to the federal government in the Constitution. And the federal government could only do those things which it was specifically empowered to do. The rest were left to the various states, originally 13, now 50 of them. So there were many things that people appealed to the federal government to change or control, which the federal government had no power to do. Thus, for example, the ancient Greeks knew the principle of the steam engine, but they didn't have the technology to follow it through. The steamship was reinvented by a German inventor a little before 1800. But he barely escaped with his life. It was again developed, started to be developed by Robert Watt and others in England. about with governmental committees and controls and control boards, that there was really no way to, no practical way to implement it. And so it happened that the steamship was developed, not invented, but developed in the United States. People opposed it there too. The owners of New England sailing ship industries wanted to get rid of the competition. They saw the threat to their industry. But you see, they could not appeal to government to get rid of this threat to them, because that would be action in restraint of trade, and it was unconstitutional. And as a result of that, the steamship was developed in America. It was sailing up the Great Lakes, up the rivers, and finally across the Atlantic, and finally captured the world's sea trade. And members of the British Parliament wondered what had happened, and too late came to realize that it was economic freedom that had given America the edge over Great Britain and other powers. Now, there are many, many examples of this, in the invention of the automobile, the development of the oil industry from nothing. As a result, within about one century after its inception, quite unexpectedly, founding fathers would have been surprised at this, the United States was per capita the richest, most prosperous nation in the world. That is, and so great was the freedom of production and trade that in one 20-year period, 1870 to 1890, the standard of living actually doubled. That is, what you could get for $1 in 1870, you could get for 50 cents in 1890. And so, that's, and you see, economic freedom was one of the benefits of having a limited government, a government in which was not permitted to interfere with production and trade. Now, this is no single isolated case. You consider East versus West Germany today, the same nation, the same people, the same national temperament, with the one highly productive and the other where production is entirely controlled by a central government and constantly inhibited, the standard of living much lower. Or take the Western nations as opposed to the Soviet-dominated nations. Or take prosperous Hong Kong as against communist China. Or consider, here's an interesting example, India versus Japan. Because here the rhetoric was exactly opposite to the fact. After the change of government in 1867 in Japan, continued to be largely dictatorships and as warlords, you know what happened in World War II. Nevertheless, the whole policy of economic freedom and free trade was, that was a 19th century policy, and the Japanese rulers did not interfere particularly with it. Especially true after World War II, when Japan was a defeated nation. And yet, it started to come out more and more enmity here. In India, when the British left it in 1948, it had a vast industry, railroad system, all sorts of advantages. There was much talk about freedom, democracy, development, improvement of the masses. But what happened, in spite of that, was that such a huge crippling bureaucracy arose in India to control almost everyone's activity that people could not rise in life. They were constantly hedged about and controlled by the central government, so that in spite of all its great rhetoric, India remained poor. What they didn't realize was just a pretty obvious lesson, though. You can't create jobs without large amounts of capital. It takes millions of rands, dollars, or whatever to start, first for the research, then to start the factory that gives the jobs, And who will invest the capital if the investor is in constant danger that his investment is going to be taken away or expropriated by government? He, of course, won't take the risk. And so joblessness and poverty inevitably result in spite of people's best intentions. Isn't this the lesson, after all, of Zaire and Tanzania and Mozambique? I mean, rich, fertile lands that are now steeped in poverty and misery. Economic freedom is what makes the difference. I wish I could continue this on a note favorable to the United States, but let me continue with the history of the United States a little bit longer in this respect before concluding with a few tentative remarks about South Africa. The picture in America is very different today. It has been for the last 50 years at least. Theft is easier than honest labor, as Bertrand Russell once said. The problem is to prohibit theft. Theft can be done through government. If you can get behind the scenes and control the lawmakers, it becomes risky and tiresome to constantly predict next year's market and wonder how much of what to make. Decisions so important that any one of them, if it fails, can mean bankruptcy of your company. It's easier to get government on your side to subsidize your industry so that you won't have to take those risks anymore. Or better yet, find ways to get rid of your competitors. That can be done. Anyways, people who are already very wealthy, like the Rockefellers, the original John D. developed the oil industry and got millions. But what happened to his descendants? They never produced anything. What they did was to make sure that they kept their enormous wealth. I mean, in a free economy, you'd have a constant turnover. Well, people wouldn't stay well off unless they kept on being able to run a company efficiently and predict next year's market and so on. They wouldn't be able to continue and have a constant turnover instead of this business of forever inherited wealth. So it's easier to get the government on your side by passing legislation. Especially if the legislation seems to be for the public benefit and not for your own benefit, then it easily passes muster with the public. For instance, no company likes to be stuck with high taxes and lots of regulations and spending 30% of its man-hour time on unnecessary paperwork for the government. But if you own a big company and are in with the government, then you can do that. I mean, it's a nuisance that you can afford to do that, but the newcomer who's just starting it has a brilliant idea and would be successful, you can stop him because he won't be able to do that. He can't hire the team of accountants and lawyers that would be required, whereas you can. So what does the current activity of, let's say, David Rockefeller consist in, largely? Well, as head of the New York Federal Reserve Bank, he sits on committees to determine how much unbacked paper money will be turned out of the printing presses next year. In other words, how much the American worker's dollar will be worth next year. I mean, this is political power, power over human beings, not economic power. Transform the materials of nature for the benefit of human beings. Now, how did all this happen? This is a transformation in less than a century, 50 years. I'll go into this a little bit because I think it holds hold certain lessons for South Africa as I see it. The courts, especially under Franklin D. Roosevelt starting in 1933. Roosevelt was the only four-term president, and he appointed virtually all the members of the Supreme Court before he was finished. And the courts then started to interpret the Constitution in ways that would have made the founding fathers turn in their graves. I'll mention just two phrases in the Constitution. One of them is the phrase interstate commerce. Well, that seemed innocent enough. If there is a river that goes through several states, for the federal government to adjudicate disputes about commerce along those rivers, because it affects more than one state. Today, the Interstate Commerce Clause is so interpreted by the courts that if you are a worker who washes windows in any building in which interstate commerce is conducted, you come under the Interstate Commerce Clause and your wages can be regulated accordingly. The Supreme Court in the Phillips 66 case in 1954 decided that the federal government, the Interstate Commerce Clause permitted the federal government to set the price of natural gas at the wellhead as long as that gas went through interstate commerce. And for reasons of appealing to public sentiment, the price was set very low, really at a loss. The result is that in, say, the oil is produced in Kansas, people in Kansas pay three times as much for the oil as the residents of Detroit, 1,000 miles away, because that's going through interstate commerce and is regulated. The result is there came to be an enormous shortage of oil quite artificially. The oil was all there, it was in the ground, but it was not worth anyone's while to dig for it. Surely that was a predictable result, and yet people were surprised and indignant when the oil was not forthcoming, because they wanted it to be both very cheap and very plentiful. And you can't always change reality to make it that way. So there would be a lot of other examples, but almost anything can come under the Interstate Commerce Clause now. So the federal government becomes increasingly important and all-powerful. The same with what's called the General Welfare Clause. I won't go into details about what that originally meant. It was a very specifically delineated power. But what it does now is to enable the central government to extract from every American citizen on an average $1,500 per year just for what's called the welfare, computer poverty. After the expenditure of many billions of dollars, poverty is no better than it was. We have $25 billion a year spent in food stamps, but you know, they are just as often traded for cocaine or what have you, and violently abused. The same with welfare checks, which permit women who have no husbands to get aid, but they have husbands, they don't get it. And the more children they have, the more income they get from the government. And it's not difficult to figure out that it doesn't cost 10 times as much to raise 10 children as it does to raise one child, so they have as many as possible and get tremendous government largesse for all this. I mean, that's all goes under the heading now of seeing to the general welfare. Again, many examples could be given of this. Perhaps I've given just a taste of it. But the whole thing has gone, it's gone wild. And although there's some signs of restoration of sanity, the fact is that there is now a $1 trillion budget every year, federal only, that doesn't include the budgets of the various states, which are now small in comparison. What's it spent on? in a book by Donald Lambro called The Federal Rat Hole. Here's just a few examples. There are hundreds and hundreds of them, but just to give you a brief taste before I go on. Federal projects, paid for by every taxpayer. One project, I won't give the amounts in each case, though I have them. To study how water extinguishes fire. To examine the impact of rural road construction in Poland. To teach mothers how to play with their children. To study wild boars in Pakistan. To prepare a dictionary of witchcraft. To figure out how children fall off tricycles. To study lizards in Yugoslavia. To provide an odor measuring machine for Turkey. To chase Central American toads. To record the smell of perspiration in Australian Aborigines. To study the frisbee. To perfect zero gravity toilets. To collect ants in Guinea. To erect a potato chip factory in Morocco, which grows no potatoes. To help officials in Kenya purchase extra wives. And there's the $2 million grant to the Air Force to purchase a simple tent, which blew away after 3 hours service. We should not forget the $60,000 every year that goes to the Queen of England for not growing corn on her farm in Mississippi. Anyway, I suppose there's comfort to Americans in the fact that they need not fear a Nazi invasion on the plate, because the government still spends $30,000 a year, an annual grant which has never been rescinded in 40 years, to maintain a military commission set up in 1945 to protect Americans from escaping World War II Nazis. According to the present head of that commission, quote, "We don't have formal sessions anymore. We just meet socially after hours. Our budget goes for salaries and entertainment," unquote. And so it goes. There's study of hitchhiking, study of why people fall in love, study of the teeth of primates, study of the Alaskan brown bear. But those are, you know, to coin a phrase, chicken feed. The bigger items, $100,000 per minute to pay the interest of a national debt, ranging over 20 years. There is a little item of $250 billion in foreign aid, which enabled the United States to finance and support both sides in a dozen wars. 3 years ago, the cost of the federal welfare projects added up to about almost $1,500 per year for each person. Multiply that by four for a family of four. And the increase is continuing. It's very hard to reverse this once you get so many interested parties wanting to push their programs. Each one says, well, cut the other programs, but leave mine alone. But then everybody says that. And the problem is that everything is then left as it was. President Reagan appointed the Grace Commission to please, please reduce these expenditures. You know, they're more in 1 year than in a whole, first whole century of American history. And the commission came up after a scholarly study with 1,025 suggestions of how to cut government without really hurting anybody. And how many of these suggestions were adopted? 25. What happened? Well, some of the suggestions were very good ones. I mean, there were 40 or 50 completely useless old Army and Naval bases scattered across the country, out of date, unusable. But there were still people there to staff them. And what is known as senatorial courtesy went to work. You pass my bill, you vote for my bill, I vote for yours. When it came to it, nobody wanted to get rid of the installations in their state. And all the attempts failed. Congress just wouldn't pass any of it. Similarly, it's important, I suppose, to keep the national parks, the beauty spots, be helpful and help to reduce the national debt to sell all those off to people who love them, who would be able to use them and use them wisely, like lumber companies. But none of it happened, again, for the same reasons as before. So we've sort of painted ourselves into a seemingly hopeless corner. I mean, there are now in America more people getting checks from the government than they're paying into it. People's mood has changed. They want something from it. They grab all the cookies they can from the cookie jar without worrying very much about how many of the cookies are going to be replaced. They want lots of services from the government. They wouldn't dare to steal from their neighbors. That would be immoral, but they will elect the legislators to do exactly the same thing. I mean, I'll get a free lunch, my neighbor will pay for it. But the neighbor thinks the same thing. So you get everybody trying to live off of everybody else. And then there are conscientious people who don't believe in doing that sort of thing. But you see, if everybody's getting a share of the pie, and I'm helping to pay for it, and other people are using it, I might as well get a piece of it too. And then production falters. And then the pie gets smaller and smaller. And so the enormous growth of the United States during the 19th century until World War I has gradually slowed down to a trickle. It's still there. There's still an enormous potential. But it's been held down, it's had a lid put on by this tremendously all-powerful central government that has arisen instead of the decentralized system that we once had. Full of nobly motivated interventions. I could name hundreds of examples. Let me give just one. In the late 1940s, the federal minimum wage law was passed. It's now illegal to pay any employee less than $3.50 an hour, about 10 cents an hour. That was supposed to guarantee everybody a decent wage. You want everybody to have a decent wage. Why not? What was its effect, actually? Main effect, it guaranteed unemployment to lots of people. Since some employers will lose by hiring an inexperienced worker at the required wage, they will do it themselves or automate the place rather than do the hiring. Those who get jobs will get more wages, but a larger number will do without the jobs entirely. Meanwhile, this has also virtually destroyed the apprenticeship program in America, whereby a person could learn a trade while he was on the job. But now he has to be paid the full amount even while he's learning the trade, and many employers can't afford to do this, so they don't train people anymore. Thus, the young person does not learn the trade. He remains unemployed, or maybe makes a living by illegally dealing drugs on the street. The result of this noble piece of interventionist legislation. In 1949, the percentage of unemployed teenagers, black and white, was the same, 12%. Today, white employment to teenagers is still 12%, and the blacks 40%. That's how much the minimum wage law protected the blacks against discrimination. But of course, it all had a noble motive. That's supposed to excuse everything. In his book in 1830, Democracy in America, Alexis de Tocqueville said, these words were really a very prescient of the future. He said that America, if it ever ceased to be a republic and became simply a democracy, it would become, and when I quote de Tocqueville, an immense tutelary power which takes upon itself to secure people's gratification and watch over their fate. For their happiness, such a government willingly labors. But it chooses to be the sole agent and arbiter of that happiness. provides for their security, foresees and supplies their necessities, facilitates their pleasures, manages their concerns, directs their industries, and what remains, but to spare them all the care of thinking and the trouble of living. The will of man is not shattered, but softened, bent, guided. Men are seldom forced by it to act, but are constantly restrained from acting. Such power does not destroy, but prevents existence, does not tyrannize, but compresses, enervates, extinguishes, and stupefies a people until each nation is reduced to nothing better than a flock of timid and industrious animals of which the government is the shepherd. End of the quotation from the Tokyo. Now, I don't want to be one of those Americans who comes to South Africa for a month or so and then suddenly becomes a specialist in South African affairs. At the same time, I cannot refrain from giving a few observations or a certain amount of lessons from the American experience. And let me conclude with a few remarks along that line. First one. Once upon a time, Washington, D.C. was a little city on a dirty river, and no one heard very much about it because there wasn't very much to administer. After all, crime and education and almost everything else were handled locally, where the people knew what the individual conditions were. Today, Washington is a powerful dispenser of favors, and as I have traveled across South Africa, up and down and across in the last month, it seems to me that Pretoria too doubles up a considerable portion of every South African's earnings. When you have a strong central government and a huge administrative bureaucracy, expenses mount, waste mounts, corruption mounts, and if I read the headlines aright, and between the lines, talking to people reliably, it seems that it has consumed the harvest and is now using the seed needed for next year's planting. America has certainly gone a long way toward that. And I want it to go the same way here, but it does. There is certainly a strong tendency in that direction, which you see everywhere. Point number two. I'll just make 3 points. Here's the second. The United States got rid of slavery 120 years ago. The 17th Amendment to the Constitution guarantees everyone, whatever race or creed, equal protection under the law. 40 years ago in the American South, it was not so, but that situation has been pretty well amended. And a person is not, he may be prevented by the bureaucracy from rising to the level of his ability, but he can't be kept down solely because of his race. I think in South Africa this is not yet true. I mean, many South African blacks proved their ability as farmers a century ago until laws were passed prohibiting or limiting black ownership of farms. Now, the world thinks of South Africa only in terms of one word, apartheid. But I don't think the world understands at all. It really misses the point. Apartheid is not evil if people of different cultures freely choose to live apart. It's evil only if they are forced to do so. And in South Africa, it's not, I think, the fact of living separately that is disturbing, as much as the fact that living separately, the cultures fail to understand one another. Black culture is so different from white culture in South Africa that it's as if they're broadcasting on different wavelengths. The black is not yet attuned to a white technological civilization. Though in his own very different way, he has remarkable wisdom and memory and intelligence. There's no reason, of course, that he should be forced to conform to a white technological culture if he doesn't wish to. He may be satisfied with the life of his forebears, and if so, shouldn't be forced to fit into the white lifestyle any more than whites should be forced to conform to to his lifestyle. Yet many members of the black culture could easily be successful in the white if they were given the opportunity. This leads to my third and final remark. The chief cause of racial frustration, anger, is not apartheid, but is discriminatory legislation, which deprives non-whites of opportunities they would often be able to take advantage of if the way were open to them. If apartheid only separated races, then Soweto would be a flourishing city with high-rise buildings and banks and department stores and markets and prosperous people. But it isn't. And the reason for this is that blacks live in a world in which almost everything is owned and controlled by the state. The state cares for them as if they were children, but doesn't allow them to control their own destinies, just like the persons described in the Dumbo quotation. Here I'm going to quote a paragraph from Leo Mao's recent book, which is a South African bestseller, South Africa, the Solution. These following words come from his, not from, me. Quote, if a white person wants to open a fish and chip shop in a white area, all he has to do is go on a farm, find his own business site, and sign a lease with a landlord. If he complies with health regulations, he's entitled to sell fish and chips. Nobody need to agree with him as a person. No questions are asked about his competence, resources. The bureaucrat decides if there's an adequate need or desirability for the shop he wants. He's entitled by right to run the shop or any other business. But for a black, the situation is very different. Before he can open a shop in Soweto, he has to ask an official for a site. The official may or may not grant the request for reasons he need not disclose. He may say yes because he likes the applicant, or is related to him, or has received a generous bribe. He may say no for equally capricious reasons. Once the site has been granted, the potential businessman has to apply to another official for a license, and this may or may not be issued for similar reasons. And then on to the health officials, and then the building inspectors, until many months and hundreds of rands later, he may be turned down for unstated reasons. And so he has no experience of law which is equally applicable regardless of color. What's experienced is an arbitrary rule by men, a system which by its nature is full of the potential for corruption. No self-respecting human being can be subjected to it for a long time without feeling frustrated and angry. That's the end of the quotation. Now, there are many problems that will take a long time to solve, like education, but this one could be solved easily if those in power were willing to do it. I mean, simply remove the discriminatory regulations, release the energies of human beings so that they can improve their state and rise to the limit of their abilities. White South Africa is losing enormously, I think, by keeping other races down and then doubling or trebling their own tax burden to provide for them as if they were children. When given the chance, they would soon take care of themselves. The Hudson Institute of New York has recently projected that by the year 2000, Japan will be the number one economic power in the world. As I read this, I thought, what a sad commentary it is on the rest of us. Here's a small island, smaller than the state of California, with hardly a single natural resource. And look at South Africa, richer in natural resources than any comparable land area of this earth. And one wonders why. The people of Japan don't have the barrier to the fulfillment of their productive energies. But South Africans, not only black but also white and so on, have endless impediments thrown in their way by the petty and not so petty regulations of their own government. There's no reason in the world, it seems to me, that it should be like this. South Africa has a store of mineral wealth unparalleled anywhere in the world. It's a geological paradise, also a very botanical paradise, beautiful land, people with integrity, energy, industry, all the makings of a nation that all the rest of the world could envy. They could well outproduce the United States. And I hope to read in the history books of 1996 that South Africa has turned its course around, that the man-made impediments to its progress have been repealed, so that its natural great energies have been turned loose and productive endeavor. And then the rest of the world will be forced to say how wrong we were about South Africa way back there in 1986. Thank you very much.
There will probably approximately 20 minutes for questions.
Sometimes it does happen that when a great injustice has been done, a restitution is called for. Paul mentions that in his book and has some suggestions about that in the case of South Africa as well. It brings up lots of problems on to whom to make the restitution, how much, who's going to compensate whom, and to what extent. Long. But aside from that, it's very dubious whether the affirmative action programs in the United States have really done that much. I mean, the 17th Amendment has, and some other constitutional changes. But as for affirmative action itself, that consists in largely in the following. That if people of, suppose that people of two, there are two candidates for the same job and they're both equally qualified, but one of them is white and the other one is black, then the employer must give preference to the black. Well, if there are equal qualifications, and they were the employer, they do that as well. The point is, there's a problem with this. Now you have an injustice to the loser, regardless of the loser's race. Suppose that you had, say, a white person who is overqualified, a black person who's not quite that qualified, and the law requires you, as affirmative action did, doesn't any longer, to hire the black or the Mexican or the Hispanic or the American Indian instead. All right, then, you know, there are things to be said for that, but there's also this to be said against it. If you keep on doing that, then you are committing an injustice against the person who has the better qualifications, who is nevertheless not hired. Now suppose that same position then later falls vacant. Then what are you supposed to do? Hire the person who was rejected the first time? But what if somebody else is better qualified than he is and is an applicant this time? Now what? You see, this could become a perpetuating thing, perpetuating itself forever. So maybe the best thing to do would be to simply consider simply to hire people on the basis of their qualifications. I don't mean just their IQ, total qualifications for the job. completely regardless of race, color, or creed. That is the tendency in the United States. Now, affirmative action has received a number of not death blows, but severe blows. And there was so much dissatisfaction with it. Because, you see, if a person is hired, suppose a teacher is hired, not because of qualifications, but because of some other reason, like race, then even if that person is eminently capable, other people, like the students, will suspect that he was hired out of pity or because of some other reason, not because of his qualifications. And that, you know, that suspicion, when sometimes not well-founded at all, but that suspicion has done more to sour race relations in the United States than if there had been no affirmative action to begin with. I think he thought he would accomplish much more than he's been able to do. After all, it's those 545 people in the Congress who have to pay constant attention to their constituencies back home, but it's those people in Congress that control the funding. All the president can do is sign a bill or veto it. He can suggest it, but only Congress, both houses, can introduce the legislation, and only they can fund it. The president cannot appropriate one cent. In that way, his powers are limited. So, if there are huge spending bills for what the president considers unnecessary spending, well, sure, he can veto the bill. But then it may pass by a two-thirds majority of both houses over his veto. And in general, Reagan's tactic has been not to do that. That is, if he sees that something is hopeless, even if he considers it desirable, if he absolutely is not going to win the day, even by persuasion, then he will, for the moment at least, drop it and live to fight another day. And then when the time is ripe, he will bring it up again. He has an excellent sense of timing, that at least must be said for him. The Graham-Rudman bill, which is supposed to extinguish the federal deficit a few years hence by gradual steps. If he had dared to suggest that a year ago, he would have been laughed out of court. I mean, Congress would have paid no attention. But since he, in a number of presidential talks to the people, reminded them repeatedly that you can't keep on spending more than you take in, people are now much more aware of this, and they want to see how their congressman votes on this. And so, in a couple of months ago, the Graham-Rudman bill passed. It wouldn't have passed a year ago, only after this presidential persuasion by a pretty good communicator did this happen. But he knew when to time it. He knew it wouldn't have worked a year ago. It has worked now. So, in that respect, people who say that he's simply a figurehead or that he is an idiot who doesn't make the decisions but they're made by underlings in the hierarchy, that's simply false. I knew him slightly, I knew the governor of California, it just isn't like that. He doesn't master a lot of details, he leaves those to the underlings, but he wants to chart the course and he knows where he wants to go. Now, second part of your question. On his stand on South Africa. He's a friend of South Africa. He's not a friend of everything that happens in South Africa. He likes consider South Africa a friend. He considers it an ally in the war, in the attempted Sovietization of the world. And it's hard in South Africa to believe the tremendous pressure that the president was under to impose sanctions against South Africa. But he resisted the pressure so far. I think sanctions would be foolish, and not only foolish, but utterly ineffective. Trade will continue. The underground economy, if not the above ground, illegally, if not legally, but it will go on. I mean, already there are plans of this kind. Stuff moves directly from Cape Town to Tokyo, but on paper it goes from Cape Town to Rome to Tokyo, unless officially it's an Italian import. You know, all sorts of things like that. It's very difficult to put the lid on that kind of thing when two people or two nations want to trade with each other. A has what B wants and B has what A wants. So it would in any case be very ineffective. There are many newspapers who wonder how could they make these sanctions stick. One, the economist in London said, well, I think the best idea is just everybody sell their gold and reduce the price of gold to about, you know, $200 an ounce. I know lots of American investors who have Kruger rents, and they are not, on principle, going to sell their gold at a price less than they paid for it, simply in order to impose sanctions on South Africa. They just aren't going to do that, and I notice in the last week the price of gold has shot up rather than down. So I think Raymond Stebb on that is quite correct. When he was forced practically by public opinion to do something on this point a few months ago, you notice how mild he made it. It had something to do with Kruger Rands. Very minor. Besides, millions of Americans have them already. And he cannot pull a Roosevelt anymore. And by pulling a Roosevelt, I mean when Roosevelt in 1933, forced by law, by a statute from World War I that was still on the books, forced Americans to give up all their gold in return for paper. That wouldn't work anymore. There are too many millions of people who have invested in gold, and there are too many people who have invested in Apple in South African Kruger. This just wouldn't wash anymore. So he knowingly did a gesture in a fairly trifling manner when it was within his presidential power to do much more extreme things. You notice he's handled it with a pretty delicate hand. He has to handle people back home. But you see, when he's convinced of something, as he is on this issue, he will act on principle. Maybe the fact that he would not be subject to re-election by a constitutional amendment has something to do with this. But at any rate, it's a fact. Most of his advisors advised him a very different way from the way in which he has actually acted. If during the 1960s, people from foreign countries had come to the American South in the Martin Luther King era and said, look, here, we'll help solve your problems for you. Probably all the parties to the dispute in America would have said, keep out, let us solve our own problem. And that is the way Reagan feels about South Africa. There are multiple problems, but it's not for foreigners to intervene and say, here, look here, we'll solve them for you. We may advise, we may sometimes advise wrongly, and maybe what I said at the end about South Africa is all wrong. It's just based on a month or so of observation and a lot of reading, and then a month or so being here a couple of years ago, and a lot of interest in the subject, and read various kinds of journals on it. But look, I'm an amateur on South African issues, and Reagan is certainly not a specialist, but hurt workers in the very category, blacks, colors, and so on, who the whole thing is supposed to protect. They would be jobless. Lots of them. That's why lots of them, since I've been here, have said to me, don't not to impose sanctions because this means our jobs. It would probably be worse still for the many thousands of people from Central African republics who come here to work. There is no work in Zimbabwe, and there is no work to be found in many of the areas to the north. So they come to South Africa to work. Those would be the first people to be sent home, because already unemployment grows in South Africa. What good would that do if the idea is to punish South Africa in order to benefit the Central African nations? It would have just the opposite effect. That's why Reagan warned Zimbabwe, look, you better don't expect any aid from us if you're going to take this action. So I think on the whole, he's right on top of it. Redistribution. I've never known one case when it really worked. I mean, what happened a few years ago in Zaire? Every bit of property was nationalized so that people could be well off. Now the place is an economic shambles, with everyone steeped in poverty. Who knows where all the money went? Probably went into a lot of Swiss bank accounts. But it didn't go to the poor people who needed it. I mean, that was an attempt at redistribution, which utterly failed, as has happened with every attempt at redistribution that I can think of. Rather, I mean, restitution, that's another matter. That's a very, very complex one, but I'm not sure that that's what you're asking about. I think the main way that America discovered is not to redistribute, not to nationalize factories or take them away or close them down, because that just multiplies poverty and hurts the very people that it's supposed to help. Rather, this doesn't solve the whole problem, but it at least gets it off the ground in the beginning, right away, is to remove the impediments so as to try to give people equal opportunities starting now. Now, it's true that some people start with a handicap and some people don't. That's too bad. I don't know how much you can do about that in the long run, but at least you can now make each person able to run the race. You see, there's something about equality of opportunity. It's a different phrase, certainly for equality of opportunity. Opportunity to do something which is not the same as equality of final product. If you had, let's say, suppose you were just starting out with the government, and you distributed 1,000 rand to each of a million citizens today. By tomorrow, some people would have spent it all, others would have spent part of it, some would have invested in it, some would have borrowed some and started a store or a factory, and within a year, you'd have the inequality again. Then you'd have to, then the government would intervene, let's say, to correct that inequality and take away from those who had made more than $1,000 and give to those who had made less, and finally, those who had worked hard to produce something would get the point, and they'd find it useless to produce anything anymore. Then you would have killed the goose that lays the golden egg, and you'd have a condition that I call splendidly equalized destitution. You'd have equality, but equality of nothing. I think equality of opportunity. You know, the main source of inequality of opportunity isn't money. If you don't have it, but there's economic freedom in the country, and you can rise to the position of earning it, then you're comparatively well off compared with most nations, particularly most nations in Africa. If you have, the main source of inequality is this. It's the family, it's parental training. Even if everybody had equal income, some children would have parents who give them their love and trust and training. And other people have parents who don't care, or who botch the job completely. And so even if you had total equality of income, you would have inequality of opportunity, because the child who grows up with love and confidence and trust and training from parents is much better off equipped for life than the child, however who doesn't have any of that. So if you wanted to really introduce equality of opportunity, you'd have to abolish the family. Now, some utopias like that of Plato even suggested that. And family is looked down upon by any totalitarian regime simply because it's competition. They want the state to have your total allegiance, family can't. So the point is, rather be, say, a child with good parents in a poor family than a child with bad parents in a rich family. So the main source of equality is really ineradicable unless you want to eradicate the family. One final comment on that. When there is equality of income, as there's supposed to be in the Soviet Union, but isn't, because the 2% on the top have everything and the 98% below that have very little. But when you have equality of income, then people will compete with each other for something much more sinister and dangerous. That is inequality of power. Money is clean compared with the power impulse. The impulse to rule the lives of others and to lord it over other people. That is what is offered in so-called egalitarian dictatorships. And of course, if you can't get it, if by your efforts you can't get more in the way of income, then maybe by your efforts you can get more in the way of power and rise high in the bureaucracy and arrest people you don't like and arrest them on no charges or trumped up charges. Consider the history of the Soviet Union under Stalin, that sort of thing. Now, that's why we have to be very careful about phrases like equality of opportunity. It would be nice if everyone had equality of opportunity in this sense. Everybody had equally good and honorable parents. Everybody had equally good and wonderful home life. I just don't know how to bring it about without the cost being infinitely greater than the benefit.
Final question. I think your comments on the trust laws in the United States.
Well, it depends on the law. I mean, the in general, I think that the antitrust laws have been helpful at all. I refer you to D.T. Amitano's scholarly book, The Myths of Antitrust. That's a long, it's a long detailed business. Governments have monopolies. Governments have coercive monopolies because they can keep anyone out of the business. The government alone runs the post office. The government alone in the United States runs the Department of Motor Vehicles. The result of that is there's no competition to go to. If you may stand in line for hours, but there's nobody else you can go to, and they know it, so they don't care. You have competition. Well, then if you don't like one store, you can go to the one across the street or a mile away. That's the difference. Now, the only monopoly that has ever really worked in the long run is a governmental monopoly because they have the use of force to keep anyone else out. You know, once upon a time, there were competing postal services in the United States, and they undercut the government. They sometimes were able, at a profit, to send letters at about one-fourth of what it cost the government to do so. Finally, the government was just about to go out of that business because it was losing. Then, of course, they passed a law around 1845. It's illegal from here on for anyone but the government to handle first-class mail, that is, letters and cards. And, of course, that is a century and a half ago. They still have that coercive monopoly. That's a monopoly that can stick because it's implemented and kept in being by naked force. The tendency of attempted monopolies which are not governmentally backed is to break down. That is, here's four people agree to charge a certain high price. It's to the interest of one of them to go against the agreement and undercut the others and make a killing. Or for some fifth one, a newcomer, to see, oh, they've all agreed to raise it. Now I can sell the same stuff for less, and I can put them all out of business, or make them over the front, and so on. So in general, comment is that non-coercive monopolies don't work. Now, antitrust is a slightly different kettle of fish, as they say. If there were an attempt to restrain trade, well, that's unconstitutional to preserve economic freedom. I would have to know really what specific measures that you had in mind with regard to antitrust legislation. See, as I read the court decisions of the original Sherman Antitrust Act of 1891, I think, the grounds on which the government did its so-called trust busting was never the right grounds. They never got at the heart of the problem. Recently, for instance, Bell Telephone has been condemned as a monopoly, and the Supreme Court has forced it into what's called divestiture, that is, into seven or eight different companies. I remember Americans complaining about that. Of course, it was not entirely private, it was partly government regulated, there's all kinds of complications. But it had a pretty good thing going. I mean, the best telephone service and system in the world is one that America did have. I say did. It's not so clear now. Now, half the time, when you have to choose between one company and another, you don't know exactly what you're getting. And now you get, for the first time, long waits and long distance calls. Bigness is not a reason. Bigness is compatible with efficiency. On the other hand, there are some industries in which when it gets big, it does tend to have too many people in the front office. I mean, Ford Motor Company almost went broke the year after Henry Ford died. When a company gets more than so large, it does tend to get inefficient, even though it has competitors. And then the newcomer, at least on the free market, the newcomer, who doesn't have all those expenses and doesn't have all that overhead, can often make it and overtake the big one. So bigness is a relative matter. In some industries, you can't get more than so big without losing efficiency and losing few competitors. In other things, like telephone service, there's a certain advantage in unity in having one system that covers the whole country and can connect with the whole world. So you'd have to take this, you know, apart industry by industry and one against the other. I cannot make a generalization for all of them that I can really honestly stand by. And that's why I have to be hesitant in trying to answer your question, you know, in general terms. I want to take the specific situation and see what happened in this situation and tell you what I think the government did or did not do the right thing in that specific case.
This answer is on behalf of everyone present. I'd like to thank you very much for sharing your time with our audience.